Six-lane highway that would have ripped Garner in half, wiping out 2,300 homes, three town parks, and our main industrial area. It also would have run right through a historical African-American church. My church.
Our community quickly formed a broad-based coalition to kill this proposal. We succeeded. A law blocking the route was passed in the General Assembly in only 17 days.
2 weeks after that bill passed, my business, a healthcare provider helping troubled youth, announced we were bringing 250 jobs and a $12 million investment to that business park that was threatened by that route.
In January 2010, when Wake County was thinking about closing the town's only library, but closing our library was not an option, not one that served nearly 600,000 people annually.
And so moms, retirees, the unemployed, business leaders, and students such as Madeline banded together to fight the proposal. In a matter of a few months, Garner's grassroots activism again produced results, and the proposal to close our library was shelved.
Garner has a community spirit unsurpassed anywhere. You see it when we hold our annual Relay for Life event to raise cancer research funds. Garner has been designated an All-American Relay Town, and for good reason. We've raised over $1 million since the inception of the Garner Relay for Life event.
You see our community spirit every day at our Garner Senior Center, which has a diverse membership of 3,500 people. The center came into existence more than two decades ago and has thrived because of local citizens and partnerships with regional nonprofits.
The center is the major hub for Meals on Wheels in Wake County. Last year, more than 33,000 meals were served in that center.
Whether it's the American Cancer Society, American Idols, or American Heroes, Garner comes together for worthy projects every time.
When Henry Sanchez went off to war in Iraq in 2006, he wanted to protect his family and friend back home. During the ambush of his unit, Henry's Humvee was hit by an RPG.
Henry was a gunner, and he climbed into his turret, even as his vehicle was engulfed in flames, and took out several enemy machine gun nests, while his comrades evacuated the vehicle and took cover. He was awarded the Bronze Star with valor for his bravery.
But my grandson Henry would receive that honor after he passed. A month after he took the heroic actions that earned him the Bronze Star, Henry was killed when an IED exploded underneath his Humvee. He was 21 years old.
Henry's sacrifice was an impetus for the Garner Veterans Memorial, which we completed and dedicated just last month. An all-volunteer citizens committee in 2009 came together to raise $500,000 for the project located at Lake Benson Park.
Fundraising for this ambitious project would have been challenging under any circumstances, but undertaking it during the worst economic downturn since the Great Depression has made this an extraordinary example of community leadership and action.
We wanted the whole community to have ownership of the memorial, and almost everyone in our community contributed one way or another, whether it was buying food from a fundraiser or one of the memorial bricks or benches that accounted for more than a quarter of the funds raised.
As a Garner resident, I am proud to have led the design of this memorial that honors Henry and all veterans. My daughters are among the many countless young people who will learn about the sacrifices of war from this project.
When my family surprised me with a memorial brick and the project's walkway of honor, I was moved beyond words. I am grateful my town has built this memorial that serves as a timeless reminder of the role of veterans in protecting our freedom and democracy.
We love you, Dad!
Garner's reaching out to local school systems to get field trips to the memorial incorporated into social studies curricula for 300,000 public school students within a 60-mile radius. As principal of Garner Magnet High, my alma mater, these outreach efforts to area schools are extremely important to me.
NC State University students are creating a brochure and a guide to the memorial for students and for the more than 200,000 people who visit the park annually. And the Regional Visitors Bureau is working with us also to promote the memorial as a destination.
Yes, great things grow in Garner, most notably our young people. As a college student, I had the privilege of being one of the founding members of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. We sought to ensure that all Americans would have equal opportunity. Several years ago in Garner, citizens realized that there were gaps preventing some of our young people from having access to the full range of opportunities.
The Community of Hope After School Program collaborates with six different Garner public elementary schools to identify students who are at risk and who are below grade level in reading and math. The program is offered to families who qualify at no charge. And since its inception in the year 2004, this program has helped over 579 children and families in the Garner area.
And we are talking about more than numbers. This is about real families like mine. We come to America looking for a better life, but we needed help for our son Fernando to reach his full potential.
When I was a third grader, I needed some extra help to succeed in school. The Community of Hope at the school program made all the difference for me. Today, I'm an honor roll middle school student.
It didn't take long. It didn't take long for Community of Hope Ministries to realize that children in need are indicative of families in need. So we began a food pantry. We have served more than 400,000 meals in the last 5 years, and we've grown 500% since 2007.
More meals were given out in January 2013 than in all of 2007. Our community is able to meet this critical need thanks to partnerships with the Regional Food Bank, local businesses and nonprofits, and Garner area citizens, including Garner Magnet High students like me, who have organized food drives that have brought in over 10,000 items for the food pantry.
And what started out as an after-school program has become an innovative community partnership that helped thousands of people in the community. That is how we grow Open Garner.
Honorable judges, I tell you, great things grow in Garner. Creating the next generation of well-rounded citizens involves more than helping them with homework and more than making sure they don't go to bed hungry. It includes developing their creativity and sense of empathy. This comes through exposure to the arts.
Our Performing Arts Center is our cultural hub, but it wouldn't exist today without a grassroots movement that saved a historic site. Today, the Garner Performing Arts Center, GPAC, is home to Broadway Voices, bringing top Broadway talent to Garner. This series was a citizen's dream. It became reality thanks to partnerships with the Chamber of Commerce, our business community, and the town.
GPAC is a home office to a broad range of community programs, including events for a Black History Month.
GPAC has provided a nurturing environment for budding young performing artists, including two of our most famous young people, American Idol Scotty McCreery, and my sister, Miss North Carolina 2012 Arlie Honeycutt.
Since 2007, a diverse collection of over 500 young people have participated in the Summer Theater Camp program for youth ages 5 to 19, offered by a volunteer community theater group, the Town Players of Garner, and held at GPAC.
Campers learn theater fundamentals in a lively program that culminates in a lavish production. Last year, we had 120 campers and 150 volunteers, and we put on a production of Disney's The Little Mermaid Jr., seen by over 2,000 people.
To make sure the camp is affordable to all, there's a scholarship program that has awarded over $5,000 and more than 50 scholarships since its inception in 2007. It's named after a sweet, gentle, and creative boy who was always eager to help, and he worked with the town players. That young man was Henry Sanchez.
Yes, great things grow in Ghana. Our citizens, nonprofit, and civic groups, and businesses, and local government work together to get things done, to honor and to say thank you to our veterans, to provide hope to families in need, and to expand the horizons of our next generation of citizens. I'm proud to call Ghana home. We are all proud of our all-America city.
Great things grow in Ghana!
Chapel Hill area. Just this year alone, just January through June, we've made it, I counted over 40, the best of the top. We're from everything, the best place to raise a family to the best place to be in business. So we're in an area that's growing very quickly. Thank goodness our town council, our town leadership have had the foresight. We've built infrastructure. We've been building it. We're still building it. Right now we have 3 school sites already acquired for our growing student population. We just did a bond referendum to continue the infrastructure. So it's, I think it's through the planning and the foresight and then the prudent spending decisions of our town council has enabled us to grow with this triangle area.
Thank you. Do you have a question? Thank you all for being here. How close are you all to I-95?
Because actually, we're going to work on that. About 25 miles.
You make the point of children in need are often indicative of families in need. Then you say that you open a food pantry, which is great, it's outstanding. But I also find, at least in my home where I live, is that those families sometimes need more than that. And how, you know, are you getting to a point where you can go with those families and help them economically, jobs, furniture, and other kinds of things?
Absolutely. I'm Amy White. I'm the director of the Community of Hope program. I'll just remind you that the program started off as an after-school program for children. It was federally funded. After 4 years, those grant funds went away, and we had to have a self-sustainable program. And what became started off as an after-school program has now grown up into a food pantry, a summer camp, a crisis housing program, a carpenter's hands program, and then this fall we will launch a program called Jobs for Life, which moves our folks from handouts to a hand up. We read a book called When Helping Hurts, and we decided that we could do more once again, and looking to serve every pocket of the community that's in need. And I'll tell you, not once did we ever cook up an idea of we think we need to do this. The need always landed in our lap, and we went to the community and said, we'd like to do this, can you help us? And as a result, when we go and run food drives in our community, we can see porch after porch after porch with groceries loaded with bags loaded with groceries for us to pick up. We have 40 corporate sponsors that help us to continue to provide for the gaps that are identified as we grow. The needs grow in our community, and that's just what we look to do, is to fill those gaps.
Good afternoon, Gardner. I've had the pleasure to be in here in your town several times, and it has grown quite a bit. And what an amazing story. And yes, you made North Carolina look great, as we are, so thank you. I'm really interested in the whole Gardner Concerned Citizens United group. I know it started because of the road, but it seems like it was transformed into a whole community grassroots effort. Can you talk about that?
Yes, my name is Elmo Vance. I am the chairman of the Gardner Concerned Citizens United. We are an organization that believe in being proactive instead of reactive, being a part of what is going on with the town. And once the organization found out about what was happening with the Red Route and how it would adversely affect the town, then the individuals within the community say we're going to band together and see what we can do to try to help the town to prevent this from happening. And as a part of that, the Uganda Concerned Citizens continue to work, not only with doing active work with the Red Route, but also with putting on the Martin Luther King celebration in conjunction with the town again. There where we put on a celebration of the life and legacy of Dr. King, and we also are able to give out and support the food banks within the town of Garner, also give out awards to individuals who are living the legacy or living the life of Dr. King, giving out their services, as well as being able to provide scholarships to those needy students.
I'll ask a question. As a former mayor and deciding to take on the Department of Transportation, it's kind of like a David taking on a Goliath story there. So how did you put that in motion and how? And obviously, you were determined that wasn't going to happen, so kudos to you.
Thanks for the question. My name's Martin Watkins, town manager. Caught us by surprise, quite frankly. Our planning director originally heard the news in a public forum. There was no communication with the DOT. And we quickly mobilized our citizens. The relationship that our mayor, Mayor Williams, had built in the community made a difference. He had been a very active participant regionally, participating with our transportation planning group for the region, the Metropolitan Planning Organization. He had been very active in Triangle J, which is our regional council of governments. Had also been active with our Wake County Mayors Group, which consists of a good number of mayors. That was our first step, was reaching out to our partners and connecting up to find out what was happening. And quite frankly, it to us, at the end of the day, it was a triumph of good sense, quite frankly, because it made no sense to build this road through, as Mr. Vance said, 13 neighborhoods, 3 town parks, and our only industrial park. It made absolutely no sense, and that's what folks continue to tell us. Everybody you tell the story to is sympathetic. Ran into some roadblocks along the way with federal government, continue to work through that, and we get assurances all along the way. And again, it's the power of a good idea. I'd also be ashamed if I didn't tell this part, is that we had a public meeting, again, with the mayor and the relationships he had built over time. We had 1,300 people show up at our biggest venue in town, which holds 471 people. And I'm gonna give credit to the mayor and it's the power of our community and spirit of our community. The mayor made sure that all 1,300 people that wanted to speak got a chance to speak that night. And it had an incredible effect.
It is impressive, very impressive. You all are just in such an amazing town. And Hugh, I think you want to ask something, do you? I'll give you
I do. The memorial, and you seem to have set it up so that people can be in it every day. It's not way out someplace. Okay? I got drafted 9 days after I graduated from college. Okay, spent some time over one of them funny places. But I think that was a wonderful idea, and I'm just wondering, can you draft that in such a way that other communities can pick that up and deal with it? Because I think the price that we have to pay is worth people going by every day.
My name is Faye Gardner, and I'm on the Garner Veterans Memorial Committee, also with the Chamber of Commerce, and you're exactly right. This memorial is a living, breathing memorial, because it is in a living, breathing park. Beautiful park, and we say that there's no price that we can put on the value of where that is. Mothers walk by there pushing baby carriages, bike riders, people walking their dogs. 2,000 people visit that park every year. We're looking forward to the 4th of July celebration when the 200,000. We're looking forward to the 4th of July celebration when the North Carolina Symphony will be there. We'll have nearly 20,000 people that will be in that park to visit that memorial. It is living and breathing. It's successful already. It was dedicated a month ago. And I deem the success of it when I think about the little boy that's 9 years old and he's down tracing his grandfather's brick and his parents are explaining to him what being drafted means. Attribute it to being a living memorial when I see a widow sitting on a bench that was purchased by her family. And I said, well, it's so nice to see you here today. She said, yes, I'm visiting with Al, because that was Al's bench, and Al had a break right down here. I see it as a success in living and breathing when we see a family sitting on a bench and a teenager playing a violin solo to honor a veteran that whose name is on that wall.
Ed, I think you've got about 1 minute here for it.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I have a question. I'm just curious about your stats. The national poverty rate is about, 17, almost 17%. And you guys are under 4%. And I know that oftentimes when we talk about poverty, you associate that with high crime rates, homelessness, and all sorts of other social challenges that we're faced with as a nation. Can you talk a little bit about some of those dynamics in your community?
Thank you. So you're correct. Our poverty rate's about 3.8, 6.4%, depending on which census data you look at, American Community Survey. And so we also, we're something we're very proud of, is that we're 70% owner-occupied housing situation. So we have, history of the town have been, we're 7 miles from downtown Raleigh. So history of our town, we've had a lot of state government, it's our state capital, our state capital is Raleigh. So we've had a lot of folks that work in state government. There's some banks that are headquartered in Raleigh, some utility company. And so we've had a great, we've been a place where lots of those folks live. And so we've had a good, steady, good working class community where folks a lot of folks work in state government or work in downtown Raleigh. So it's been a good stability. I think over time, the town has prided itself, we do more Raleigh, prided itself in making sure that we have programs and that we, we've had a pretty strong police presence as well in terms of proactive policing. We certainly have a community policing philosophy. We've had a nationally accredited police department for about 15 years. And so trying to take all of those things into account, it's just a wonderful community.
Garner, I have to thank you for coming. And the grandmother, thank you for being here today.
Mayor Ronnie Williams.
Thank you. You know, people are congratulating me, but I could not have made it without this team. One comment about veterans, for those deployed veterans. You left somebody at home, for those spouse to stay at home, looking after those kids, paying the bills, keeping the bills fed. Congratulations, and y'all need to be honored too. So, give them a hand.